Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpinder Singh and we are going to start with the daily current affairs. So today we are going to start the current affairs for the 6th of January 2021. All right, and I am basically covering the two newspapers, the Hindu newspaper and the Indian Express also. You can refer any of these newspapers. And you can get it the daily current affairs, right? You can read both of these newspapers also. Both of these newspapers are equally good. All right, so let's begin with the daily current affairs news. All right, so the first news is related to the Toyota-thon 2021. All right, so what is this Toyota-thon? So first of all, you must understand it is an hackathon basically, where the different stakeholders involved, right, for making the different type of designs of, you know, the toys and different type of, the issues which is related to the Indian culture. So it is basically related to the manufacturing, the design, the toy experts, right? You will have the different type of startups which can basically bring different type of ideas for developing the toys and the games. Why we are having this hackathon? This hackathon will be basically based on the Indian culture and the ethos. So the Indian government basically is pushing, right, to make those designs, right, to make those, you know, the toys and the games, which is based on the Indian culture, which is based on the Indian ethos, and which is based on the Indian folklore and the heroes, right? So here in this context, the Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Women and the Child Development, and the Ministry of Textile, Ministry of Commerce and the Industries, Ministry of Medium Small and Ministry of Micro Small and Medium Industries, all right, and Ministry of INB and All India Council for the Technical Education have jointly launched this hackathon, which is known as the Toyota-thon 2021, right, which is also, you know, launched the Toyota-thon portal. So what is the ultimate purpose of this hackathon? So, right, this ultimate purpose of this, you know, Toyota-thon is basically to have a platform where you will have the different stakeholders. These stakeholders are basically the students, the teachers from the schools, the teachers from the colleges, okay, the design experts, the toy experts, and the startups, right, which will be, you know, bring together, right? Why we are bringing these stakeholders together? So that they can basically crowd the source ideas, right? So ultimately you have to build up, you know, certain toys and the games. These toys and the games which will be based on the Indian culture and the ethos. So ultimate purpose of the government of India is to build, right, those toys and to develop those toys and the games which basically gave some of the significant insights about the Indian culture and Indian ethos and Indian heroes also. All right. Now, the second most important aspect of this, you know, the Toyota-thon is not only, developing these toys and the games, which is based on the Indian culture and ethos. The second most important aspect also, right, to develop India, right, into a global hub for toys and the games, right? Because you must understand, most of these toys and the games, which is basically, you know, originated from, you know, either from the China, because China has the, you know, the greatest capacity in terms of the developing of these toys and games. And India is also lagging behind in that, right? And the second most important point is, if you make the India self-sufficient in basically, you know, making these toys and the games, or making the India as a global hub for the toys and the games, it will definitely help our children, right, to understand those values, because through the toys, through the games, you will basically, you know, impart those values. You will basically impart those ethos, right, which are ingrained in our Indian culture. And that is what is also emphasized in the National Education Policy 2020, right? So it has the dual task of, first of all, having different stakeholders on the platform, right, through the schools and the colleges and the design expert, which will ultimately bring different type of resources, right, or the different type of ideas for development of the toys and the games, right, which have the, you know, certain basis on the Indian culture and the ethos. All right, and the second most important point is it will also help the, you know, the country to develop into the global hub for the toys and the games. That will also benefit the India in terms of export of these toys and the games. And not only, it will also help our children to understand the Indian values, the Indian ethos, which are also emphasized in National Education Policy 2020. All right. Now, this Toycathon, which is also Hackathon, is based on the 9 themes. It is based on the 9 themes. So these toys and the games will be developed on based on these 9 themes, right? So these 9 themes are basically the Indian culture. This is the first theme. Second is history. Then knowledge of India and the ethos, learning, education and the schooling, right? The social and the human values, the occupations and the special fields, the environment, Dibyang, the fitness and the support, out of the box, creative and logical thinking, and rediscovering and redesigning the Indian traditional Indian toys. All right. So these are some of those themes based which the toys and the games will be built, and that will basically boost or impart the Indian culture, Indian value system, Indian ethos in the minds of the children, in the minds of the children, right? And this Toycathon basically will have the 3 variants of the track, right? Which is at the junior level, senior level, and the startup level, right? This will definitely allow the different participation of the student and teachers, because as I told you that it has the involvement of the teachers, right? The startups, the students, right? From the schools, colleges, universities, right? And also it will also have, you know, the participation of those startups, which basically involve in, you know, making of these toys and the games, and also some of the toys experts will also be participating in the Toycathon. So Toycathon is basically a special type of hackathon, right? Where you will have the different stakeholders from the school, colleges, and also the design experts, toy experts, right? That will bring the new ideas, new insights about the development of the toys and the games, which will have the roots, right, in the Indian culture and the ethos, right? Definitely it will also build the India as a global hub for these toys and the games, and it will help our children to understand the Indian value system, right, the Indian ethos, right, which is also emphasized in the National Education Policy 2020. And as I told you, the Toycathon is basically based on these 9 themes, right? So based on these 9 themes, right, these games and, you know, the designs, the toys will be built, and that will have the participation from different stakeholders, right, which is at junior level, senior level, and startup level. All right, so this is, you know, poster of the Toycathon, right? All right, 2021. All right, let's start with the new news, which is the Swasth Vayu. So what is this Swasth Vayu? So first of all, you must understand, it is an indigenously designed and developed. So it is basically an indigenously designed and developed ventilator. Okay. Okay. So ventilator is basically a medical equipment which provide the oxygen, or which provide the oxygen supplementation to the patients who are basically critically ill, right? So so you must understand that an expert committee, which was constituted by the Director General of Health Services under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, right, have concluded that this Swasth Vayu, which is also, you know, the indigenously built and designed 19 patients who require the oxygen supplementation up to 35%, right? So that will basically, you know, remove the need of the hospitalization of the patients, and also that will also contain the spread of COVID-19 virus also, right? So the so not only in the India but also throughout the world, there are the shortage of the ventilators. Okay, so these ventilators are, you know, the life supporting instrument or life supporting medical instruments, which are basically provided the optimum amount of oxygen to the critically ill patient. So that will basically, you know, the oxygen supplementation device. All right. And these ventilators, which are crucial for the survival of the patient. If there is a shortage of these ventilators, right, obviously the COVID-19 related, you know, pandemic will become more worse, because the serious patients will not be able to survive in the absence of these ventilators. All right. So the Council of Industrial, the Council for the Industrial Research, right, led the National Aerospace Laboratories, has indigenously designed and developed this non-invasive, bilabial, positive airway pressure ventilator system, which is known as Swasth Vahu, which is known as Swasth Vahu. So it is non-invasive, right, which can be also used at your homes also. Now, as I told you, this Swasth Vahu, which is a non-invasive ventilator system, which is developed by the Council for Industrial Research, led the National Aerospace Laboratories, right? It is a microcontroller-based precise closed-loop adaptive control system, right? Which will be built in the biocompatible 3D, you know, printed manifold with coupler, with have, you know, some of the high efficient particulate air filter system. So that will provide the patients with much relief, and that will also, you know, help the patients to get the oxygen supplementation up to 35%, right? So it will be useful, right, for those patients who require the oxygen supplementation. All right. And you must understand, this Swasth Vahu would also have the unique features which will definitely help to alleviate the fear of the virus spread, right? And this basically, some of the special features, like you have seen the bi-timed spontaneous auto modes, right, with the provision to connect the oxygen concentrator or enrichment units externally, which does not allow the, you know, touching of this device, which basically removes the fear of virus spread. And CSIR led this National Aeronautical Laboratories already commercialized this technology, right, with the help of 6 private companies. Now these 6 private companies is in the process of manufacturing these ventilators, which will be useful in safeguarding the life of the patients which are basically affected by the by the coronavirus, right, or with other serious, you know, medical issues. All right, so this is basically a ventilator, so which is made by the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, led the National Aerospace Laboratories, Bengaluru, which developed this non-invasive ventilator, which is also known as the Swasth Vahu, right? This would be, you know, this was developed in just 36 days for COVID-19, right, recovery, or for COVID-19 patients, right? And this is how the ventilator, and you can see how the ventilator can be used for recovery of the COVID-19 patients. All right. Next, Moringa. Okay, so Moringa, let's first see the picture of the Moringa. Okay, then you will be able to feel and visualize what is Moringa is. So Moringa is basically, you can see these are the Moringa leaves, and these are basically some of the drumsticks, right, which are also used for varieties of the purpose, right? So these are Moringas. So first of all, you must understand, this Moringa have the greater, applications. For example, the Moringa powder, right, is of great demand, right, for its nutritional properties, the India is also exporting this Moringa powder, right, to some of the Western countries also, and it has certain other qualities also. We will learn. So first of all, the Moringa is in the news because of the India started exporting the Moringa powder, right? So the India started exporting this Moringa powder, keeping in mind the rising demand and the nutritional properties, right? So it has the huge global demand and also the nutritional properties also. Now, the 2 ton of the organic certified moringa powder was already exported to US, right, on December 29th, 2020. Right, the regarding moringa, the moringa's botanical name is Moringa oleifera. The Moringa oleifera, which is a drought resistant tree, right, and which is basically the belongs to the family of Moringaceae, right, which is a native of Indian subcontinent. And you must understand that India is the largest producer of moringa. The India is the largest producer of the moringa in the world. And the moringa generally grows in the wild, and it is generally cultivated in the Central America and the Caribbean region. It is also cultivated in the northern countries of Southern America. It is also cultivated in Africa, South Asia, Southeast Asia, and various countries of Oceania. So that means it has, you know, it has the diverse geographical reach of their, you know, the of their cultivation. But the India is the largest producer of moringa, and the common name for the moringa, which we use basically either moringa, right, or the drumstick tree, or the horseradish tree, or the bean oil tree, or benzo live tree. So there are the different names for the similar product, which is also known as moringa. And globally, the demand for the moringa product, like, you know, the moringa has the tremendous applications also. For example, the moringa powder is also used, right? So you have the moringa leaf powder, which is made up of the leaves of the moringa, right? You have the moringa oil, which is basically, you know, this oil is drawn from the moringa plant, right? It also, you have the drumsticks tree, which the drumstick would be used for, you know, various purposes, right? And that will not only have the nutritional, you know, qualities, but also have the medicinal and culinary uses also. So it will have the diverse applications for the use of this moringa, plant. And this is basically the leaves of the moringa. From there, the moringa powder was exported to the US. All right. Next, the Alphavet Workers Union. So this is in the news because the Alphavet INC, right? You must understand, right? The Alphavet INC, which is basically, you know, the Google's parent company. So which is basically the Google's parent company, right? Have organized, like, few workers basically organized a secret, you know, sitting or secret union, right? For the part of a year. And they also started electing, you know, their leadership also for this workers union. But you must understand, this workers union has nothing to do with some sort of a, you know, concession with the Google, right? So concession to the Google or Alphavet, you know, which is also parent company. Because first of all, the Alphavet workers union is not at all a normal trade union, which is of greater, strength. It is just consisting of the few workers only. And moreover, the purpose of creation of this Alphavet workers union is not to bargain from the Google or not to get some sort of a concession from the Google, but rather to have, you know, some sort of a structure and the longevity to the activism at the Google level, right? So here you will have the more than 225 Google engineers and other workers have formed this union, right? And it is basically, you know, capping the years of growing activism as one of the world's largest companies, and which is, you know, for this, you know, having some sort of a staunchly anti-union Silicon Valley, aspect. And this basically union which is formed is also known as the Alphavet Workers Union, right? The Alphavet is basically the Google's parent company, right? So this Alphavet Workers Union was formed by few, the Google engineers and the workers in secret for better part of the years. And the engineers and the workers which involve in the Alphavet Workers Union, they are also affiliated with the Communication Workers of America. This Communication Workers of the America is a union, right, that represents, you know, the workers in the telecommunications and the media, which are there in the United States of America and the Canada. So it is basically affiliated with that union, with that union. And as I told you that unlike the traditional union, right, which demands some sort of a concession, some sort of a bargain from the employer, it does not have any such, you know, aspect. So it is a minority union, first of all. You cannot compare the traditional union. So it represents basically a fraction of those companies' employees because it is only involving only 225 employees. The Google's parent, you know, the employee strength is more than 2.5 lakh employees, but it only consisting of only 225 employees. The main purpose of this Alphabet, you know, the union or Alphabet Workers Union is not to, you know, to bargain or not to get the concession from the Google, but to give the proper structure to the activism process at the Google and to give longevity to such activism at the Google. And it has no such, you know, no such purpose of negotiating for any sort of a contract with the Google. All right. So that is the news which is flashing in the Hindu newspaper. All right. Let's understand the Sagarmala seaplane services. The Sagarmala seaplane services. All right. So Sagarmala seaplane services. So first of all, the seaplane services means there are the planes. They are the normal planes which can basically land in the sea, which can take off from the sea. So they are called seaplanes. So Sagarmala means the Sagarmala is basically associated with the ports and related infrastructure, the ports, waterways, and associated infrastructure, right? So here the seaplane services which will be connecting these ports, right, or these waterways, right, it is an ambitious project. So it is basically the project which is led by the Ministry of Port, Shipping and the Waterways, and which is basically, you know, having sort of a association with the airline operators. So here you will have, you know, starting the commencing of those operations of the seaplane services, right, on the selected routes, right? These selected routes will be decided by, you know, by the government of India or by the Ministry of Port, Shipping and the Waterways. And they will be started, right, under the special purpose vehicle framework, right? So here, the special purpose vehicle, it is basically an agency which will be created, right, for through this prospective airlines operators. And this will basically, you know, select the routes, and this will basically commence the operations of the selected routes. All right. And as I told you that the project execution and the implementation would be done through some of those special purpose agency. This special purpose agency is also known as Sagarmala Development Company Limited. So the implementation and the execution would be done through the Sagarmala Development Company Limited, and which is also working under the administrative control of the Ministry of Ports, Shipping and the Waterways. Right, the ultimate aim of this seaplane services is to connect, right, certain selected routes or certain destinations through this seaplanes, right? And the several destinations are also emphasized for these seaplanes operations. For example, the proposed destinations or the proposed pairs which was decided under this seaplane services is basically the islands of Andaman and Nicobar Islands and the Lakshadweep. So that two islands would be connected through this seaplane services. Guwahati Riverfront and basically Umranso Reservoir in the Assam, both will be connected through this seafront. All right. And the Yamuna Riverfront, which is located in the Delhi, it will be connected to the Ayodhya, right? So these are some of the destinations or some of these pair and some of this origin and the destination pair, which will be connected through this seaplane operations. And you must also understand that one such seaplane service is already taken place or already going on between Kevadia and the Sabarmati Riverfront in the Ahmedabad, right? In which the Modi also had the sortie, right? So this was initiated, right, or this was inaugurated by the Prime Minister on 31st of October 2020. So you might have heard this news that between Kevadia and the Sabarmati Riverfront, already the seaplane services is already started, right? And to start more such services, especially in the coastal areas and you know, proximity in such water bodies, the Sagarmala Development Company Limited, which is a special purpose vehicle, right, which is created, right, is keenly associating with all sort of, you know, airline operators which can fly the seaplanes between those destinations. All right, so it is basically, you know, connecting those destinations which can basically use the seaplane services. All right, so these are the places, right? You can see basically some of those places or proposed locations for Sagarmala seaplane service. So you can see basically the Guwahati seafront, the Umrang So Reservoir, the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, right? And you have basically the Iral Dam in Chandrapur, right? You have Ayodhya, you have Srinagar, you have Tehri Dam, you have Yamuna Riverfront, Delhi, Chandigarh, right? Like that, you have the different places which will be connected through this Sagarmala seaplane service, right? So slowly in the phased manner, they will be connected. They will be connected, all right. And it will basically help in, connecting those places which are still not connected with any sort of a, connectivity or any, air connectivity. So that will also help in the air connectivity between those places which are also not connected through air, all right. Next, Mannathu Padmanabhan, okay? So that is basically, Mannathu Padmanabhan, basically an Indian social reformer and a freedom fighter, okay? So he was basically born in 1878 and he died in 1970 and he was basically from Kerala. So he was basically the Mannathu Padmanabhan, right? And the Prime Minister Narendra Modi recently paid a tribute to Padmanabhan on his Jayanti, right? And now you must understand his contribution also, because since the news has flashing, so you must also understand the contribution made by the Padmanabhan. Okay, the contribution is, first of all, he is recognized as a founder of Nair Service Society. So right, this Nair Service Society is basically an organization for the welfare of the Nair community, especially the Nair community, which is primarily found in the Kerala, right? Which is primarily found in the Kerala. And for welfare of such community, the Nair Service Society was formed by the Mannathu Padmanabhan, right? And you must also understand, he also revived the old concept of village societies, right? This old concept of village society, which was also known as Karayogams, right? Which is, have some sort of a practically set for tenor of the family and the village life. So he was also associated with it. And he also took part of the Vacuum Satyagraha. Okay, you might have heard this one through the modern history. He was also involved in, the Guru Vayu temple entry Satyagraha. So he was associated with both of these Satyagrahas, which was happened, right, in 1924 and 1931 respectively. Okay, and moreover, he was the first president of the Travancore Devasum board. And he basically revitalized many such temples, right, which was almost ceased to function. So he had the greater contribution to the revitalization of the temple. He had the greater contribution to the revitalization of the old concept of village societies, which is also known as Karayogams. And he, along with, some of the churches, right, has led to the opposition against the state communist ministry, right, which is also known as the Vimocha Samaram, right, which is a liberal struggle which basically led a united opposition against such state communist ministry. And the last is basically he was awarded the Padam Bhushan in 1966. And he was also honored the Bharata Keshri Award or title by the President of India. Okay, so he has a greater contribution because he has participated in the Vacuum Satyagraha. He was also participated in the Guru Vayur Temple Entry Satyagraha. He was also associated with the revitalization or reshaping of the village societies, which are also known as Karayogams. And he was also a founder of the Nair Service Society. And he was basically a social reformer. He was also a freedom fighter, isn't it? And he was also the first president of Travancore Devasum board. And he was also you know, led an united opposition against the state communist ministry. And he was awarded the Padam Bhushan, and he was also honored with a title called the Bharata Keshi by the President of India. All right. Let's understand the next news. All right. So he was basically the person who is known as Mannathu Padmanabhan. All right. So let's understand the rice export. Okay. So first of all, the news which is flashing is that the world biggest exporter of the rice. Okay. So now what is the news which is flashing, right, is that the Vietnam, which is also the world's third largest exporter of the rice, right, which started buying the rice from India. Okay. So now the news is related to the export of the rice from India to the Vietnam, right, for the first time in the decades, right? Why the Vietnam started, you know, importing the Indian rice or Indian grains, though despite of the fact that India is a rival of the Vietnam, or Vietnam considered the India as its rival, because in the Vietnam, the first time, you know, the local prices jumped to the highest level, and there is limited supply of the rice in the markets also. So Vietnam is forced to import the rice from India. Okay, so that is how the news which is flashing. Okay, so context is very clear. The Vietnam did not export and did not import the Indian rice because it was, you know, a rivalry in terms of the export of the rice. The Vietnam was the third biggest exporter of the rice. The India is the largest exporter of the rice. So the buying of this rice from the India would be definitely, you know, not beneficial for the Vietnam also. But this time the Vietnam started importing the Indian grain also. Okay. Now, this purchase of the Indian rice basically underscores the tightening supply in Asia. Okay. So you must understand that I have already told you that the Vietnam, there is a limited supply of the rice. So in the Asian region also, there is a tightening supply on the Asia, right? That could basically pick up the price at any time in 2021. All right. And you have some of the traditional buyers, right, like Thailand, Vietnam, which generally do not, you know, import the rice from the India. Now they are forced to switch to the India, which is also the world's biggest exporter of the rice. Now, in 2020, the India exported 14 million tons of the rice, which is the largest in the world. And this data basically, you know, taken from the trade ministry. So the Vietnam and the Thailand was forced to look to the Indian for their for mitigating their growing need of the rice. All right. So this is the map you can see here. The Vietnam, Thailand, which is basically a part of the countries which basically imported the Indian rice. All right. Let's understand Aurangabad. Okay. Aurangabad, first of all, you must understand it is a district in the Maharashtra. Okay. Now there is a demand, or there was a demand of, you know, of from the basically, you know, from Shiv Sena to rename the Aurangabad as a Sambhaji Nagar. Okay. So it was a huge demand, right, from the various political factions, including the Shiv Sena, to rename the Aurangabad names as the Sambhaji Nagar. Okay. Now, why, first of all, the Shiv Sena is demanding, okay, that it should be named as a Sambhaji Nagar? Because you must understand that, first of all, you should go back to the brief history of this Aurangabad. Okay, so first of all, this Aurangabad region, okay, was, you know, an imperial capital of Satvahana dynasty, okay, in around 1st century BCE and 2nd century CE. So it was an imperial capital of Satvahana dynasty, right, which is in the name of Paithan. So Paithan was an imperial capital, right? And it was also known as Daulatabad or Devagiri, right, which is the capital of Yadava dynasties. These both Satvahana dynasty and the Yadava dynasties both located within the limits of the modern Aurangabad, which is there in the Maharashtra. So, all right. So it has the tremendous political significance that the imperial city called Paithan, which is associated with the Satvahana dynasty, and the imperial city called the Daulatabad, which is also associated with the Yadava dynasty, were located within the limits of the modern Aurangabad. And the Aurangabad was built basically in 1610 AD by Malik Amber of the Nizam Shahi dynasty. And later, this was renamed as Aurangabad by the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, right? So why the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb has renamed it, right? Because he made the Aurangabad as its capital of, you know, the Deccan region of the Mughal Empire. So in the Deccan region of the Mughal Empire, the Aurangabad was the capital of the Mughal Empire. Now what happens is, you know, the Aurangzeb who lived in this Aurangabad, you know, city until his death, the Aurangzeb basically tortured and killed the Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj. The Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj was basically the son of Maratha warrior king, who was also known as Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. All right. So he was basically the son of the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. So the Aurangzeb basically killed the Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj, right? So that is the reason now Shiv Sena is, you know, demanding to revert back to its name called Sambhaji Nagar, because the Aurangzeb has killed and tortured the Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj, and right, in order to commemorate the contribution given by the legendary Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj, the Shiv Sena is asking to rename the district of Aurangabad as is Sambhaji Nagar. All right. Now this controversy has led to the war of words between the ruling Maharashtra Vikas Agadi, right, which is basically having the having the alliance of Shiv Sena and the Congress and BJP. Okay, so you must understand the Aurangabad is basically an administrative headquarters of Aurangabad district. It is the largest city in the Marathwada region, which is also the drought-prone region. Okay, and this entire region of Aurangabad is basically covered by the Deccan troughs or the lava flows, right, of Upper Cretaceous or Lower Eocene Age. All right, and this city of Aurangabad is mainly associated with, you know, the cotton textile production and artistic silk fabric production. All right, so it is associated with the cotton textile, because you must understand that the region of the Deccan traps is basically having the black cotton soil. Okay, so this black cotton soil is also associated with the production of the cotton. So that is the reason the cotton textiles are having the major flip in this region. So that is the reason the city is also known for the major production center of the cotton textiles, isn't it? And in 2019, the Aurangabad Industrial City is also named become the first greenfield industrial smart city of India under Smart City Mission. So it has the greater, significance also in that aspect also. All right. So that is the reason this city is in the news. All right. So let's understand the new news. All right. So this is the diagram you can see here, the Aurangabad. Okay. Let's understand some of the reports of India's Meteorological Department. Okay. So according to the report of India's Meteorological Department, the year 2020 was the eighth warmest year since 1901. So 2020 was the eighth warmest year. Okay. So you must understand, since 1901, the 2020 was the eighth warmest year, and it was substantially lower than the highest warming which was observed in 2016. Okay. So it is basically a statement given by the Indian Meteorological Department. So the other data which is also shown by the IMD shows that the last two decades, between 2001 and 2010 and 2011 to 2020, were also the warmest decades on the record, right? So which is the warmest decades in the record means the anomalies of the temperature, which was recorded as 0.23 degrees Celsius in the decade of 2001 to 2010, right, to 0.34 degrees Celsius in between 2011 to 2020, indicating the overall rising in the temperature. So that much rising in the temperature was observed, right, in terms of the anomalies of the temperature, right, rise in between these two, you know, the decades, right? And the 12 out of the 15 warmest years since 1901, right, were during the last 15 years, right, in between 2006 and 2020. So you can see that since 1901, if you compile the data, you have the 15 such years, or 15 warmest years, okay? Among the 15 warmest years, the 12 of such warmest years occur in between 2006 and 2020. So which is also an alarming, because in the span of just 14 years or the 15 years, you are having the 12 warm years. And if you compile the data since 1901 to 2006, you have just 3 warm years. So that is also a cause of concern. And the country's average, you know, annual mean temperature during 1901 to 2020 shows an increasing trend of 0.62 degrees Celsius per 100 years, right? Which is also the significant increasing trend of the maximum temperature, which is basically in the range of 0.99 degrees Celsius per 100 years, right? And relatively lower increasing trend of 0.24 degrees Celsius per 100 years in the minimum temperature. So which is also the cause of concern in this regard, All right. Next, during the year 2020, right? The annual meaning, the annual mean land surface air temperature, which was calculated as average all over the country, was 0.29 degrees Celsius above the mean normal. So you see, basically, this data is based on the data which was compiled between 1981 to 2010. So annual mean land surface temperature was also 0.29 degree, you know, above normal, which is also cause of concern. And the five warmth year was also recorded, right, in the year of 2016, right? And it was 0.71 degrees Celsius higher than 2009, which was 0.55 degrees Celsius. 2017, which was also the warmest year, right? And you have 2010, which is also the warmest year, all right? And you have also 2015, which is also the warmest year. So, right? So you have 2016, 2009, you have 2017, you have 2010 and 2015, which are the warmest year. Okay. And regarding the northeastern monsoon held in 2020, right? In the month of October to December, because you have the retreating time of the monsoon in between October and the December, right? So you must understand that the overall rainfall of the country as a whole was normal during this northeastern monsoon, which is also 101% of long period average. All right. So this is the figure which shows in terms of the temperature rise. Right. Next is related to IIM Sambalpur. Right. So IIM means Indian Institute of Management. Right. So they are the premier institution for the management. Okay. So the news which is flashing is that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi has laid the foundation stone of the permanent campus of IIM Sambalpur. The Sambalpur is basically a district in the state of Odisha. So it is a district in the state of Odisha, and this Sambalpur is basically located on the banks of River Mahanadi. You know, Sambalpur has also the linkages of, you know, some of the ancient places, right, which is also having some of the recorded settlements in the prehistoric age also. All right. So most important, the aspect here is that the Narendra Modi has laid the foundation stone of the permanent campus of IIM Sambalpur, which is also known as Indian Institute of Management Sambalpur. The Sambalpur is a city and the district in the state of Odisha, and which is basically located on the banks of River Mahanadi, and it has certain linkages of the prehistoric time. And why the Sambalpur is known as the Sambalpur is known for the Sambalpur sari, right? Why the Sambalpur sari is famous? It is famous for incorporation of the traditional motifs like sankha, shell, wheel and the flower. So this motifs, which is basically, you know, the shell, wheel and the flowers, which are incorporated in these Sambalpur saris. And this fabric or these saris are made up of the fabric which is woven on hand loom itself, right? So there is no power loom which is involved in the manufacturing of this fabric. And the Hirakud Dam, which is also the longest earthen dams in the world, right? And it is also the artificial lake of the Asia, largest artificial lake of the Asia, is also located in the Sambalpur district. And the Sambalpur basically derives its name from the goddess Samlei, right? The Samlei, who was regarded as a deity of this region of Sambalpur. And the most important is that the Mahanadi Coalfield Limited, which is a subsidiary of the Coal India Limited, have made its headquarters or have had the headquarters at the Sambalpur. So it has a tremendous significance in terms of the Sambalpur. So first of all, the foundation stone for the Sambalpur was laid by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The Sambalpur is a city and a district, right, at the in the Odisha, and it is located on the banks of Mahanadi, River Mahanadi, and its prehistoric significance. It is famous for Sambalpur sari because it is made up of a traditional motifs, which is consisting of the shell, wheel, and flowers. And it is, this fabric is basically made up of the hand loom. And the Hirakud Dam, which is basically located at Sambalpur, which is also the largest earthen dam, and which is also the largest artificial lake in the Asia. And it is named after the goddess Samlei, and the Mahanadi Coalfield Limited has its headquarters at Sambalpur. All right. So this is the news related to IIM Sambalpur. So this is the campus you can see of IIM Sambalpur. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. This is all about the news, right, for 6th of January 2021. We'll meet again tomorrow for 7th of January 2021. Till then, thank you very much.